We are live. So there's this old cartoon that I like. Single panel, the setting is a farmyard where an alien spacecraft has landed. Stairs descend from the flying saucer and down comes the alien, this short creature with what looks like a human hand where its head should be. The farmer named Roy approaches the alien spacecraft and enthusiastically shakes hands. The caption reads, "Inadvertently, Roy dooms the entire Earth to annihilation when, in an attempt to be friendly, he seizes their leader by the head and shakes vigorously." Poor Roy. Poor Roy. Just imagine the UFOs appear over the farm. It's a moment unparalleled in human history, and Roy thinks to himself, "This is my moment to shine. I am going to be this ambassador of human warmth and acceptance and goodwill." He approaches in friendship, without fear, unarmed, and you can just see this moment of recognition when the alien steps out. He sees the handshake, and he thinks, "I know what I'm supposed to do." And the world is annihilated. Poor Roy. You ever felt like Roy? Sure that what you're doing is the right thing to do, done with only the best of intentions, following the better angels of your nature, only the impact of what you do is very different from what you had set out to do. Have you ever been in Roy's shoes before? There's a story I heard recently that reminded me of this cartoon with Roy and the aliens. The story ran under the headline, "Seattle teen calls out her dad's Native American art, he learns she's right." The story involves a father named Bruce and his teenage daughter, Sarah. They're a white family of European descent, and when they moved to Seattle years ago, Bruce browsed at a local art gallery and found a stunning Native American robe, which he bought and hung on the wall in the family's dining room. It hung over the family dinner table for 2 decades, until Sarah, when she reached high school, saw a picture of a similar-looking robe in her high school social studies class. Learning that it was a robe worn during sacred ceremonies, Sarah began to question her dad, asking, "We're not Native American. Is it really appropriate to have another culture's sacred object in our dining room?" Bruce's initial response was to dismiss his daughter. He said, I felt like I was on the wrong side of a protest rally with terms like cultural appropriation and sacred ceremonial robes and completely inappropriate in terms like that being thrown at me. I got defensive at first. I was like, "Come on, Sarah, this is more of the political stuff you all say these days." Finally, though, Bruce gave in to his daughter's protests and decided to write to a Native American museum to ask about the piece. He received a response that said, quote, "I'm not going to tell you what you should do, but your daughter is right." The written response went on to say, "This is a sacred ceremonial robe that would be owned communally by an entire clan, passed down from generation to generation, and holds a tremendous amount of cultural significance." Bruce reflected on this, decided to take the robe down off the wall, and with the help of the museum, made contact with the tribe to which it belongs and arranged to have it returned to them. I like this story a lot. Bruce, all the way through, seems like a nice guy, and his original actions are done with good intentions and with respect. He's new to Seattle, so he buys something local that celebrates the rich cultural heritage of the area. It's an act of appreciation, celebration, and open-mindedness. But then years later, he receives new information. Not everybody else sees his well-intentioned act the same way that he does. In fact, if he were to have a Tlingit tribesperson over for dinner, they might not see the act as well-intentioned. They might make them uncomfortable, even offended. And what I really like best about this story, is Bruce's willingness to change course, to turn, to admit that he had been wrong, and that isn't an easy thing to do. He didn't have to do this, of course. He could have rationalized his purchase of the robe. He could have said, well, I bought the robe fair and square. If it's so important, then that gallery shouldn't have been selling it. He could have stubbornly clung to his intentions as justification. I meant well. But Bruce doesn't rationalize, he doesn't justify. When confronted with new information, he changes. He shifts his worldview in a way that is uncomfortable and responsible. I like that about Bruce. The title that I eventually settled on for my sermon this morning is the title Beyond the Golden Rule. Beyond the Golden Rule. Probably a lot of us, we've heard of the Golden Rule, right? The Golden Rule is found probably most famously in the Gospels of Matthew and Luke, in which Jesus says, "Do to others what you want them to do to you. This is the meaning of the law of Moses and the teaching of the prophets." But the Golden Rule is actually not just the property of one religious tradition. In fact, this teaching about reciprocity is universal. Variations of the Golden Rule are found in ancient Egyptian, Greek, and Roman religion, in Hinduism and Buddhism, in Confucianism and Taoism. Growing up as a Unitarian Universalist, I remember a UU church that I went to when I was quite young with a poster on the wall with variations of the Golden Rule from a dozen different religious and cultural traditions. And as far as an ethical maxim goes, the Golden Rule works really well a lot of the time. However, there are times when it is problematic. There's one version of the Golden Rule which helps us to see those occasions when it might not be so useful. This version of the Golden Rule appears in what is known as the pseudo-canonical Jewish scriptures known as the Apocrypha. Pseudo-canonical. I actually said it the right way the first time, which I didn't think I was going to be able to do. And in there's a text in there known as Sirach, which offers the following ethical commandment, the following version of the Golden Rule. Quote, "Recognize that your neighbor feels as you do, and keep in mind your own dislikes. Recognize that your neighbor feels as you do, and keep in mind your own dislikes." It's a variation of the Golden Rule. And that's the problem with the Golden Rule. It can fail us when we try to apply it across cultural difference. A recent article from Psychology Today agrees with me. It claims that the Golden Rule only works as long as different people in different groups all want to be treated in the same way. Think back to Roy from our cartoon. Roy was probably following the Golden Rule. He was treating others the way he would want to be treated. He was greeting others the way he would want to be greeted. But that doesn't work out so well for Roy, does it? So maybe there are times when we have to go beyond the Golden Rule. There's another rule for ethical engagement that has been imagined that is said to supersede the Golden Rule, and it's known as the Platinum Rule. Has anyone heard of the Platinum Rule? I've got a few hands up here. The Platinum Rule was, people believe, first appeared in the writings of a philosopher named Karl Popper in his classic book, The Open Society and Its Enemies. And I just have, it's in here somewhere. I actually just started reading it. Haven't come across it yet, though. But in The Open Society and Its Enemies, there Popper writes, "The Golden Rule is a good standard which can perhaps even be improved by doing unto others wherever possible as they would be done by." So not do unto others as you would have done to you, but do unto others as they would have you do unto them. The idea of the Platinum Rule actually gained popularity in the 1970s when it was adopted by the business and marketing world. who wrote about applying the platinum rule in management and sales and things like that. The difference is that while the golden rule is self-focused, the platinum rule is other-focused. Do unto others as they want you to do unto them. In this case, if Roy had followed the platinum rule, Roy the farmer would have had a lot more success if he had asked the aliens, how can I greet you in a way that feels warm and welcoming to you? They would probably say, don't grab me by the head and shake me. Bruce from our story, I believe, was following the platinum rule when he returned the ceremonial robe to the tribe. He asked not, what do I want, but how can I treat you in the way that you want to be treated? But, and here I'm gonna muddy things up some more, the platinum rule actually has its own set of problems. The platinum rule works really, really well across cultural differences, as well as across differences in personality and style. But the platinum rule hits a snag when there are real power differentials. Treating those with power the way they want to be treated can exacerbate oppression. Karl Popper actually anticipates this, saying that we should treat people how they want to be treated whenever possible, but that there are situations in which we shouldn't. This actually led Popper to formulate his famous paradox of tolerance, which goes like this. Popper writes, "We should therefore claim, in the name of tolerance, the right not to tolerate the intolerant." We should therefore claim, in the name of tolerance, the right not to tolerate the intolerant. My remarks this morning occur within a specific cultural moment, and it is a moment that is paradoxical. On one hand, this is a moment where the bar is being raised. This is a moment in which, when we talk about and interact across differences, differences in race and ethnicity and culture, across differences in gender and gender identity and gender expression, this is a moment when the bar has been raised and we're being asked to do better than Roy. This is a moment when, like Bruce, we're being challenged to learn new ways of being. This requires moving from the self-focus of the golden rule in which your own worldview is centered to more of a platinum rule approach that is other-centered. At this moment in time, I feel like I am being constantly called to aim for a higher bar. And it isn't always easy. There are new pronouns to learn, them and there, and they don't roll easily off of my mouth. I'm being asked to examine the ways in which I talk and am and use power and terms like mansplaining get used, and I have to rethink and recalibrate myself. And that's true. It's a moment where actually people are being called to a bar that's being raised, and there's this choice about whether to become defensive or to turn. On the other hand, I'm making these remarks this morning within another kind of cultural moment. On the one hand, this is a moment where the bar is being raised, and on the other hand, it's a moment where the bar is being lowered, in which the voices of hatred and racism and Islamophobia and anti-Semitism, misogyny, and homophobia and transphobia seem more strident, more public, and more dangerous. And so I want to suggest, like Popper suggests, that the platinum rule doesn't work as well in the face of threats, hostility, or the desire for dominance and conquest. If Roy approached the aliens and said, "How would you like for me to treat you?" and the aliens respond by saying, "Become our slaves, for we are the master species," the platinum rule doesn't work so well. As it was told to me, the platinum rule requires mutuality. In the absence of mutuality, true mutuality, other ethical standards are called for. So that's where I leave things this morning, in this space of paradox, where at the same time, the bars to which we're called are being raised and lowered. And in this time, I find myself trying to be more like Bruce. Take those times when I'm like Roy and say, how can I react to them in a way that's more like Bruce? Hope these fuel some good conversations among you. And I leave you this morning in this place of paradox. Let's figure it all out. Amen. Blessed be.